So, good morning, everyone. The meetup for a new code quality series, and we are going to discuss about OOPS concept in the first meetup of the series. For that, there are few new people. So, just a quick introduction. My name is Kapil Sharma. I'm VP Technology here. I'm working in Para Feature Development. 13 plus years. Below is some of my contact details. Twitter, Facebook, I am not very active, still there. LinkedIn. So if you want to contact me anytime later, Twitter is the best option. Then this slide and all of my slides are available at speakerdeck.com/Kapil Sharma. So after the meetup, I will upload this slide as well. So maybe you want to just remember that, otherwise, all things we are discussing will be available there. About PHP Reboot, so it's a developers community in Pune. We started in 2014. From then, we are conducting a regular meetup every 2-3 months. So this meetup is happening after some time. So probably as most of you have already RSVP, we manage all meetups at meetup.com, like PHP Reboot. Our Twitter handle for PHP Reboot is PHP Reboot. Again, we also have a Slack group. So if you want to join Slack group, then join at phpreboot.signup.team. Again, we have a YouTube channel as well. So whatever meetups we conduct, I record them and upload them. So here's the channel where you can find. Obviously, it is not visible. So before we can get a customized URL on YouTube channel, we need some minimum number of subscribers. So I would request if you can subscribe so that we can get an easier URL for YouTube channel. Other than that, PHP Reboot is sponsored by JetBrains. I guess Samuel knows JetBrains. They provide some quality ID. And as a sponsor, they provide the IT license for Ruffle. Would not print this time, but maybe next meetup I will refer that. Other than that, the electrodynamics systems are also our sponsors provide space and internet for the meetup. So yes, why we are here? Understanding both concepts?
Yes, everyone knows
you. This is basically code quality series. So, object-oriented programming is also an important concept of code quality. So, we are not going to discuss what is class and object. I guess everyone of you know about that. So, first thing, what is code quality? How will you say the code is a quality code? Is there anything you can define what is quality code? I want to define it in simple words. Since I have a code written, how will I say it's a good code or it's a bad code?
There are multiple factors that depend or affect the code. Like if we talk about now the principal side, like we had discussion on solid also. So practically, we are not implementing many kinds of solid, but your class should be what we can say open enough to understand.
Right. So, one thing is solid. If it is following solid principles or not. Anything else?
It should be secure.
Sorry?
It should be secure.
Secure? Yes, code should be secure. That is the important quality, but it is not a part of code quality, right? It's more of a functional. Not functional requirement, but a server requirement. So obviously this is important. I am not saying that it is not important. But If your site is not secured, you will not say your code is having bad quality. Right? So security is a completely separate topic.
Nowadays, mainly we are using APIs. So, like, it's not part of code quality, but your middleware is coming to the picture. So, your output should be in such a manner, like, according to your requirement, you can change the output.
So, actually, there's quite a few confusions, actually. What is code quality? So there are many principles, solid principles, then there are design patterns, MVC is one of them. Then for web services, there are different things, SOAP, REST, RPC, and all that. They're just a way. Right? So have you heard, definitely everyone had studied mathematics. Math, is that a difficult subject or easy subject? So probably most of the engineers. But again, there are lots and lots of people who think maths is a more difficult subject. Right? The reason? You cannot learn maths. Right? You have to understand the concept. So if you understood the concept, it's easy. If you could not understand the concept, there's nothing difficult than that. Similarly is the code. If you understand the concept, it's easy. If you do not understand the concept, it's a difficult. So at the root level, there are only two things which defines if your code is a quality code or not. Number one, it should be easy to read. And number two, it should be easy to explain. If your code has those two properties, it is have a good code quality. All other things like solid or design patterns or refactoring, they all have the same goal of achieving these two things. So that's why these are the core basics which we have now. These are two very simple ones, but achieving them is not easy. Right? So we'll be discussing more about that. So first, easy to read, just why it is important. So there are few famous quotations. Anyone heard about the name Martin Fowler? Anyone heard the name refactoring? So Martin Fowler was the person who initially designed refactoring technique. So he's a very experienced programmer. So one of the famous quotations from him, any fool can write a program that computer can understand. Good programmers write the code that humans can understand. Right? So we should be writing our code so that other human, other programmers who is reading our code, they can easily understand. Now, even if you write the whole project in a single file, your computer is not going to complain about it. It's simply executed. Example, minified JavaScript file. Right? We cannot read, but computer can easily execute. So we should be writing our code for the human's code. Computer can execute correctly. Optimization is important, but again, our code mainly should be for the humans to easily read. There's one other, simple is better. Simplicity is the prerequisite of reliability. So yes, this is very, very important. Your code should be very simple to read. There are many things, like you already suggested, solid. There are many others. So, maybe in other meetup topics, we'll be discussing about that. In this second, we are going to concentrate only on, but I will come back to simple. Otherwise, easy to extend. Now, what is easy to extend? There's a proverb. Change is the only constant in this world. You can be 100% sure whatever requirements you have right now, those requirements will be extended. So if there are new requirements in future, your code should be easy to extend. You cannot go to the management and say, earlier I have write a code which cannot be extended, so we need to put all the code in the dustbin and we need to write from the scratch. right? We can't say that. We say that we are in trouble. So it should be easy to understand. So how will you make it easy to explain? So solid principles, this is one important thing. O. What is O of solid?
Open
flow principle. Right?
Open
for modification. Yes. So our code must be open for extension and closed for modification. Not open for modification. Right?
Yeah.
So our demo project will discuss how these things are, how we implement these things. So, what we have to achieve? Easy to read. How we can achieve that? I mean, there are again some broad level points. We'll be discussing that in the code example. So, easy to read. That means your code should be easy to read, right? If a new developer joins our team, he should not need maybe a week or 15 days or even a month to understand the existing code, right? If a new developer is taking that much time to understand the current project, you can simply say your code is not easy to read. One very good example. So whenever a new developer joins, we ask them understand that code. And if he cannot understand it in a week, that means I need to think if my code is really good or not. Then there are a few other things, like it should be very simple. Right? We see a proverb, simple is better. So that stands for keep your code simple and stupid. Right? There are occasions where we need to make the things complicated, but most of the time things can be done easily. So don't use code to show that you are a very good programmer and you know lots of things. Keep it simple. Simple is always better. Then solid, we already said, S stands for single responsibility. So, if you now take it as an example, you have to make a new software and you get software requirement specification of 1000 pages. What will be your first reaction? Software kya banao, usko padhne mein 4 din lagenge, right? More than a novel. Novel generally is of 400-500 pages. Right? So, that is not simple. Yes, I need lots more detail, a very basic level detail, but to start to make the initial architecture, I don't need all these things. So, that is not simple. Now, apply the same principle on your class. If your class are doing lots and lots of things, you have say more than 15-20 methods, each method has 70, 80 or even 100 lines of code. When a new developer comes, obviously we need lots of time to understand that. And it's a good indicator that your code is not good. So S stands for single responsibility model. We need to follow that very strictly. One class should have only one responsibility. Not only to the class, even to the method. One method should have only and only one responsibility. And we already discussed our class and method should be small. If it is small, it's easy to read and understand. That consistent standards, there are lots and lots of standards, right? There are PSR2, there are peer coding standards, there are Zend coding standards, and you name, there are maybe more than 100 coding standards. So if one developer is following one coding standard, second developer is following some other coding standard, and third developer is not following any coding standard at all, what will happen? Will your code remain easy to read? No. So, I'm not recommending follow any particular coding standard, but within a team, decide one particular coding standard. Each and every member of the team should know and follow that coding standard. And again, same apply for naming convention. There are many ways of naming convention. Someone prefers a snake case. Someone prefers a camel case. That's fine. But each member of your team should adhere to one naming convention and stay on that. And again, naming convention has a lot more things. It should be a detailed name, but obviously not a whole paragraph. I should not write a paragraph as a name. Now, what are some common properties of easy to extend? If I match, extendability, easy to meet new requirements without breaking existing order. Right? So, and again, there's one principle here, DRY. It stands for do not repeat yourself. So if there's common code that you have to write twice in the whole project, that's a good indicator that you are doing something wrong. One code should not be written twice. It should be reused. And here, solid single responsibility is important. Here, open source principle is important. Of course, code should be open to extension, but it should be closed for any module. So, by that what we mean, your class and your method should have only and only one reason for change. So, for example, you're writing a calculator, an addition operator. So, it should change when the requirements of addition change. If requirements of subtraction is changing, addition code should not be updated. So that is open. Again, a small class and methods is important here as well. But if you are having bigger methods, that it's not easy to extend. And it will introduce some repeated code. It should be modular. We are thinking about very small project, but if we have bigger project, then you should define different modules of your project, and they should be separate. And continuous refactoring, that is very important, because no one is perfect. You will introduce bug, you will write that code, but continuously refactor. And test driven development is a very good example. So it's not only help to write testable code, it also help to make a good code. Because for testing, in test-driven development, you write tests before your code. So you think from user perspective, what user requirement would be at very smallest unit level. And you design those right. So test-driven development is important. But now, we are coming back to our topic. So this meetup is mostly about oops. But for code quality. So, there's a famous, not a famous proverb, oops, follow it or fail it. So, if you follow it, good. If you do not follow it, there will be lots of oops moment. So, what is object oriented programming? A class and object. We are having class and object. Is it object-oriented programming? Class and objects are two most basic building blocks. But if your project is having class and object, it doesn't mean it is following group principles. So, just although it are they are very basic building blocks, we can say just a subset. It's not whole. So going back to college days, we define when someone asks what is oops, we say these four keywords: encapsulation, abstraction, inheritance. But again, is it? These are the concepts when we are studying in our college. We don't know either we'll use any programming language to write a project, or we will deny a compiler. So that is basically for compiler designers, that if you want to design object-oriented programming, these are the very basic things that the programming language should support. And that is supported by each and every programming language. If I simply replace it by actual thing, so encapsulation abstraction, that can be done by classes. Inheritance, that can be done by interface, abstract class, or parent child, superclass, subclass. Polymorphism, that is, can be done by overloading and overriding. So PHP, although do not support direct overriding, that's fine. Speaking in general, PHP support overriding indirect. These are the basic concepts, but again, this is not it. What is object oriented programming? Again, why it will help us in code quality? Well, this is code quality series, right? How OOPS is going to help us in code quality? There is one very important thing that most persons develop: interfaces, abstract classes. That is very powerful concept, but I would say more than 90% of developers need that. So this time we are going to concentrate on these things, how they actually help us. So to start off, what is interface? That is one of my favorite interview questions. What is the difference between interface and abstract class? What is the difference? Most student answers, even freshers can answer. In interface, we declare methods. In abstract class, we can declare as well as define methods. Is it all? How many of you heard the concept of coding for an interface? A very powerful concept. And maybe you have done it indirectly. No one heard the concept coding for an interface?
Talking about inversion of control.
Yeah, dependency injection or inversion of control, nearly same thing. So these all are fancy words,
Right?
I would say these are the marketing words by frameworks in the programming language.
Okay, so a contract
give the definition of that method. How it is going to help. That is the very basic thing. In interface, I am declaring methods. If I am going to implement an interface, I have to define those methods. But how it is going to help me in code quality? Now, by code quality, I mean easy to extend, easy to create.
When we are creating interfaces, we are defining what needs to be done. And when we are implementing, that class implementation can change means.
That is an important point. Interface defines what, concrete class defines how. But again, how is it going to help me?
Theoretically, I read about it, but not practically implement. Like one thing like.
Oh, we'll see a practical example.
Yeah, like your high level modules or high level classes should not depend on your low level class.
Yes, that is an important concept. We'll check it with an example. But before that, how many of you were there in Laravel meetup? Anyone was there? So, next few slides I have taken from Laravel meetup slides. So you can download the whole slides at speakerdeck.com/kapilsharma/laravel. So, I have taken just few slides. Everyone is using MVC, right? and it's a simple diagram describing everything. The question is, where will keep business model?
Model?
Okay. Many people say, again, this is also one of my favorite interview questions.
In a current scenario, the controlled model are not good enough to put our
business model. Right. So, I'll come to that. So, model is the right answer, but there is a big confusion. Model is not a class, model is a layer. So, in many frameworks, we say model is a simple data setter class with few variables and data setter methods. And that class represents a table. So, just that's a model class. But this model and that model class is not there. This is a model layer. All the services, repositories, they all come in that layer. So this is not model class, this is model layer. M of MVC is not model class. So yes, business logic will go in model, but not in model class. So, but before going there, what is business logic? So, for example, I have to design a page where I need to show the list of active users. What is active? Maybe for my project, active user might be the user who has logged in today. For other project, it could be a user who has logged in at least once, even 10 years back. That definition changes project to project. So, what is active user? This is something defined by business model. This is business model. So, where will be keeping that business logic? Views, obviously no. Just a presentation here. Controller, if you put it in controller, it will be again dry principle. Because if we need to use the same logic somewhere else, I have to repeat that code. Obviously, controller is not a good place. Models. So, if by model you understand model class, no, not model. But in the service layer, which is part of model layer. So, I mean, picture says lots of words. Quick diagram. This is my client browser sending a request to controller. Controller going to service. Where I am going to keep my business logic, which will be going to define what is active user. It will be connecting to model class, which will be fetching data from database. Is it correct? Any problem there? What is the problem?
Problem, if we write direct code in the model.
Right?
If we write direct code in the model, if we want to change it.
So, no, I am not, by direct code, do you mean business logic?
I am talking about the interface, we have to use the interface over there. So
but why? It. How it is going to help us?
You can extend it, let's say, for example, thinking about, select, we are using MySQL, and I will just change it in the post-case, and all other technology. It will impact our project.
How it will help?
We are using interface.
So, how we should do it? There is one more thing. These models are just plain PHP class, or if you are in Java, plain Java class, both those, which represent one row of a table. So, why I want to design interface for that? Because my two tables are not going to have same data. So, defining interface for model, how it is going to help?
Not for model, I'm talking about the extra layer for that.
Right. So, that layer is called repository layer. Now, here comes programming to an interface. So, what is interface? That is very simple. I guess everyone is clear about that. But in simple words, it's a contract. So, programming for interface basically means you need to focus on what, not how. So interface focus on what you need, how you need to do it, which is a question answered by implementing class. And caller need not to worry about that. So in the previous model, what was the problem? I am still writing the code in the services. Now, if I want to change, say this is my SQL database, say I want to change it to NoSQL, what will happen? My models will change, the way of handling my models will change, I need to make the changes in service, and service contains my business logic. That means just for changing the database layer, I have to touch the code where I have written my core business logic, which is very dangerous. Now with this, if I want to go to NoSQL, now if that MySQL repository is implementing a repository interface, I can simply create NoSQL repository which will be implementing same interface. But again, it will change my service, because in service, right now I am calling MySQL repository, but going forward I have to call NoSQL repository. Will it change my service? Why?
It will call the same methods that are defined.
A method or thing, but creating instance, MySQL repository instance or NoSQL repository instance?
If we need to go for dependency injection.
That's where dependency injection helps. So, we'll not be creating the instance in service, we'll be using dependency injection. And that dependency injection, now how to implement dependency injection? There are many ways. There is a factory method that we'll see in the example. Then most of the framework nowadays come with their own container implementation. So you can define all the objects and get the instance from the container. So there are many ways. So that's why I said dependency injection is a fancy word by marketing, but yes, that is the concept. I'm not going to touch my business logic. That instance will be created on the at runtime, and at runtime I will change the code to create instance of NoSQL repository instead of MySQL repository.
But Kapil,
my
question is, our service will understand only one way of input, like if it passes JSON, then it will understand only JSON, or it will see the way I pass the data. So where I do that changing in the repository, because MySQL will return data in a different format, and
so that's where the work of repository comes.
So in the repository, I have to write that code for
changing. We basically need to return the models, right? And models will have methods to access the data. So again, this MySQL and NoSQL might not be the right example. So obviously there will be some complications, but that is at very high level to understand the concept. We'll be implementing it with another program. So let's go for a code example. Now, this is the problem statement. Just on a side note, that was the problem I got as a coding challenge. And I applied for a job here. So I was not supposed to make the whole code, but the architecture. So the problem is, we want to build a calculator that receives two numbers. Law operation. Simple. I guess even the college student has made the calculator in the college days. But that second line is most dangerous. We do not know what kind of operation we want to do yet. We'll get that in future. So maybe it is a calculator just to understand what we are supposed to do, but assume it as a business requirement. And today we don't know what will be the future business environment. And this calculator may have really complex operations. So it's not always addition, subtraction. There could be complex operations like calculate income tax, calculate that, calculate the x, y, z, blah, blah, blah. There could be really complex operations. So currently, we have just put operation plan, sum, and that. And now different team will be adding parallel operation to this guy. Okay, consider this is a big project. And a team of many developers are working on it. And each team will be working on one operation. That means one operation cannot affect other operation. How will you architect that? Any idea? We already have some hints, coding for interface, dependency injection. The dependency injection will not be used. It will be used but in a different way. How will we do that? The thing is, if I design a new operation, I should not touch the existing operation.
For each and every operation, I will create a different classes.
Yes, that will help. Then, how do you call those classes? But your main business logic is defined. You have to. Main business logic is which operation class I need to call. I need to go in that business logic and change again and again. As soon as I add a new operation, I have to make the change there. How will you fix that? So you want to write it?
The calling of the class should be the dynamic, like if I pass a particular operation.
How will you
make it dynamic? And like in the call of using dependency injection
of the class name of the operation should be designed. But again, I have to make a very simple program. So you will define your own container for dependency injection, or you use the container from any existing framework?
I might use it from another framework. No, but I'll go with my container.
So how will you design that container?
In a simple way, I'll create an object class of mine.
And the okay, a lateral. So whatever example I'm going to discuss, obviously I cannot go through each and every line of the code. So I have already created the solution and committed there. So you can simply go and check out from there. So, first problem. We do not know future operation. Right? And that is the real case scenario in all the projects. So, what principle must be followed? Open close principle. It should be open for extension. So that it can support future operation. But it must be close for modification. So we obviously need a contract. Let's define a contract. Operation contract, which has just one function, execute, which will get a number array and which will return a float after the operation. So valid contract, each and every operation is following that contract. Will be easy. So we have that interface in place, a contract. Now we have to define the operation. So for each and every operation, I am going to create a separate class. This is where many programmers think like, if I am going to have 1,000 operations, should I create 1,000 classes? Yes, you should. Your project is supporting 1,000 operations, then you have to create some. Now, don't consider addition and subtraction as operations. We are discussing about real time problem. So, if your project is big, feel free to create a class for that. Right? Having more number of classes is not a problem. You have to achieve all those functional requirements, achieving all of them in one class, that is going to be a mess. If it is a different responsibility, now addition is a different responsibility, subtraction is a different responsibility. Maybe in that it might not sound right, but again, say for example, calculating income tax is a different responsibility, calculating VAT is a different responsibility. That makes more sense. So, define different classes for them, and it will also help in achieving keep it simple and stupid principle. It will, if I am defining only one operation in one class, it will be simple. So operation class, again I am implementing an operation contract, so I have to define execute. Now this is where refactoring comes into place. You might be thinking of validate here, and again, fortunately PHP provides an easy way to solve, otherwise we'll be having a for each, going through each element of array, adding them, at the end, returning the sum. So there could be some mess. So validation is one response, right? And addition is different response. So they should be on two different things. So yes, this whole is addition, but validation is different response. So we have a different method for that. And again, if we have 10 or 15 things there in one method only, then if someone is reading your code, he can read do A, do B, do C, do D, do E, and it is very easy to identify the bug. A bug in any particular place, and I can read that name directly, I will simply go to that method. Not staying in the whole project, kahan se kya ho raha hai, kaise ho raha hai. So now, coming to that question, how will you get the instance of operation? How will you get the object of that operation class? The thing we are discussing. Dependency injection is, yeah. I would again say it's a fancy word. That's a simple thing. Have you heard factory pattern? It's a type of dependency. I need some object and it returns me some object. Simple. A calculator factory, get operation. In that, I will be passing the string with operation. And again, I want to. Now, it is making it very simple. It will support four operations: plus symbol, sum, add, addition. For all of them, it will return an instance of addition class. Now, here important note, we are returning operation contract, not addition or subtraction or multiplication. We are returning operation contract, the interface. Can we have instance of interface?
No. But you can return the interface.
Yes. So your class, if implementing an interface, you can refer it as an interface. So object will be for the concrete class, but you can refer it as an interface. But yes, in that case, you can use the method define an interface on. So keep the things very simple. Hook has everything. So I'm not saying dependency injection is not needed when our project requirement increases. We have to create several thousand type of objects. Then dependency injection is really important. This is a very simple use case.
Can you please repeat the for that we are returning the interface?
Yes.
But we are creating an object of class and returning the class object.
Yes. So that class is implementing operation and contract. So in type hinting, it will work.
Okay.
Right? But again, our operation contract define only execute method. So with the object written by that, I can only use the execute method. If addition class defines some other method, I go to addition class. On that object, if I will try to call validate, it might not work. And again, if there is a operation not found, simple return of exception. So this is another important point you have to take. So, someone is passing me an operation name which my system do not support. It's an error. And in object-oriented programming, right way to handle the errors is exception. So, we should not return like 0 or minus 1. Right? That's not a good way. Because any operation could have a valid result of 0, could have a valid result of minus 1. Even if it do not have, returning a number and deciding based on number is not a right way in object-oriented programming. In object-oriented programming, right way to handle an error is exception. So now the real to use for this pattern. Main thing, our business logic should remain agile. If I introduce a new operation, my core business logic should not change. In that case, core business logic is identify which is the operation and do that. So, the code I already committed and I used the Symfony console for making a console application, running application. But Symfony console is an easy project. I'm not going into details of Symfony console. You can simply go to Symfony console documentation and read that. So I have just taken the main core part. So I have put everything in try block. From calculator factory, now input that get argument. It's a way of Symfony console to get the command line argument we passed. So I will get the operation from command line. Pass it into a calculator factory and it will return me the operation. Now I don't care what operation it is. It could be addition, it could be subtraction, but I don't care about that. I need what? I don't care how the low level class is doing. I just need the assurance, yes, that class can do it. So that's all. I am just interested in what I need to. I don't care how I need to do it. Here. So, this is a quick validation. So, let's leave that part. Now, result operation.execute and I pass a number error here. It will give me the result. I'm simply displaying that result. So, I don't care what the operation is. I don't care how it is doing it. I just know. If I call the execute method of operation, my operation will be done. And again, this code can have some error because again, if I don't know what the operation is, how can I validate if the data for that operation is right? So there could be an exception. So I'm just catching the exception here. So in case there is any exception, my operation class will throw an exception. I will simply catch that exception and give the exception message to the end user. Now, this message contains the actual message which is sent by operation class. Easy. Output, if you want to run that code, simply clone that repository, go to that class, do composer install, but you will need Symfony console, add PHP calculator, calculate, add. Again, leave it for a moment. It's a Symfony console way, but we could have easily do PHP calculator add. So calculate add 2, 3. It will return the result. But instead of 3, try passing a character. It will throw an exception, and my class will handle that and use it. So. Now you know how to use a exception, also coding for an interface, dependency injection, yes, it's an important concept, but we don't need the fancy things for that. A simple factory pattern can do it. We need to decide the scenario and what tools we need to use. So what will be taking from there? Reviewing the things again. Now it makes sense how to make your code readable. Your code should be, it should be having less time to understand your code. So no matter how many operations I add in that way, will it be easy? My core logic is not changing. What I have to do, I have to add a new operation class, extending operation contract, and update the factory. It is simple. all of my class and methods are very small. It's easy to read. Single responsibility. They are following single responsibility. We have a small class and method. Consistent standard and commonly agreed naming convention. That is something I leave on you. You need to decide what coding standard you want to follow, how you want to name the thing. But it should be consistent. For extendability, can we meet the new requirements without breaking existing things? Are we following do not repeat the author? So actually, we are not.
We are repeating
many times. Yes. So that's why we are not. So, maybe I was out of time, but again, that validation, if it is a common validation, we should take it out to a separate class.
And the typing also complicated, should not be complicated. Otherwise,
it should be protected or private. That depends. That is debatable. So, it depends on person to person.
Yeah.
So, I would not recommend anything which could be debated. Are we following open close principle? Our code is open for extension. Can I add new operations there? Is it closed for modification? Adding new operation, is there any chance to break my existing code? For adding a new operation, the only thing I need to modify is the factory. So I can break the factory. No, I can introduce a syntax error there. Again, then anything will not work. I can identify that on development box only, not on the production. Do we have a small class methods? So again, I have not done it in test-driven development way. Again, we do not have a big code to do it modular. So if these things are happening, then I can say code is easy to read, it is easy to extend, and if these two conditions are followed, then I could say our code quality is good. That's a simple way to identify if your code quality is good or not. Any questions? Close it.